being 10 minutes into our start time. So, Mr. Clerk, can we start? Are there any changes to the agenda?
There are no changes to today's agenda, Mr. Mayor.
Are there any declarations of interest? Hearing none. Motion to approve the minutes of our last meeting. Morelli, Marula, all in favor? That's carried. We have no delegation requests for today. We do have consent items 5.1 through 5.3. So, on any discussion respecting these items? Motion to approve items 5, moved by Whitehead Duval, all in favor? Question on 1.
Yeah, just on 5.1, through you to the Medical Officer of Health. You're reporting that we had a significant jump in 2012 with West Nile. What program, are we going to still continue the programs where we treat water sitting still on property we own? And I'm thinking of all these wet ponds, these stormwater management ponds that are wet ponds. I see Elizabeth pointing to Rob. Are we going to continue that program? Because if we're seeing a spike, that'll make the communities nervous. And these wet ponds are all over the city now, where water sits idle, particularly during the dry spells like we had last summer with the droughts that we experience. Any comments on that?
Through you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, the larva surveillance program will continue this year, and that's part of the report we wanted to bring forward, just an information report to say that last few years have been pretty nasty, and we want to continue on with our larval surveillance, the larva sighting of those identified standing water sites that are on city-owned property, but we also will investigate any standing water sites on privately owned property and take action where it's needed through the standing water bylaw that's already in effect. So yeah, we will be monitoring those sites, and we have a contract with a professional pest control company to apply the larvicide where it's needed.
Okay, and to the private person who has a pond in their backyard, and the best advice to them is to, if they want the pond, because it's nice ambience, is to have some sort of device, a fountain or otherwise, that keeps that water moving. The slightest ripple will kill the lava, is that correct?
Yes, through you, Mr. Chairman. I will attempt to answer this, although Susan Harding Cruz, the manager of the vector-borne disease program, has pretty much the most experience in the city in dealing with all these issues with West Nile virus. I know that traditionally, moving water is not a breeding ground for the larva, but I can ask Susan to elaborate just quickly on that for you.
Thank you, Rob. Through you, Mr. Chair. Yes, that's correct. If the mosquito will not develop when the water is moving, that's why really standing water or stagnant water is needed. And you need a period of at least 7 days for the mosquito to go from egg to adult.
So if someone runs a small little fountain inside one of these backyard ponds, that creates enough of a ripple to be able to prevent these things from hatching them, does it?
Yes, as long as there's ongoing agitation, then the mosquito is not interested in laying the eggs on the water.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you very much. And I'm sorry, Councillor Whitehead.
Yeah, could I just ask, last year, because I guess of the type of climate that we had, it was a high year for West Nile, and I read there was a number of deaths or sickness attributed directly to West Nile, and not just in Hamilton, but Southern Ontario. If I was to educate my residents in anything they can do, for example, types of plantings and so forth within their backyards, are there things that can mitigate the attraction of mosquitoes into one's yards?
Through you, Mr. Chair, the best thing to do is remove all areas of standing water. So anything that may accumulate water that could stand for 7 days needs to be removed. So if you've got any plants in containers, you need to look at the water. Even if it's about an inch or so deep, that's enough for the mosquito. Really for vegetation, you can keep your yards well manicured and trimmed, but really it's the water that the mosquitoes are looking for.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And so on receiving and approving, all in favor, that's carried. I think we had a mover and a seconder, Mr. Clerk, right. All right, we now have before us 7.1. This is the presentation respecting oral health, and time for the staff to come down.
Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? Let's move things a little bit here. So I'm pleased to provide you some highlights from our Oral Health Report 2013. This report presents an overview of the oral health of residents in the City of Hamilton. We have included national and provincial data to assist you in comparing results that measure how Hamiltonians are doing in comparison to Ontarians and Canadians. Social determinants of health strongly affect an individual's oral health. I'll provide some highlights of that relationship. Public health services provide a number of dental programs to support good oral health and access to oral health treatment. I will describe briefly the work that we are doing to support oral health in Hamilton. The Ontario Public Health Standards, OPHS, includes a protocol for screening and ensuring that children receive treatment for urgent dental needs. Results from this protocol provide evidence to guide future program planning and delivery of services. Oral health is connected to overall health, so what happens in your mouth affects the health of the entire body. Tooth decay is the process that results in a cavity or dental caries. It occurs when bacteria in your mouth produce acids that destroy the tooth structure. If left untreated, tooth decay can cause pain, infection, and tooth loss. Periodontal disease, also known as gum disease, affects the structures surrounding the teeth. Over time, the attachment between that gum and the tooth breaks down. Research has provided evidence that a number of serious health conditions have been linked to periodontal disease. Poor oral health can affect overall quality of life. People with oral health problems may suffer from poor self-esteem, which in extreme cases can lead to social isolation. Most people know that they should see a dentist regularly and take care of their teeth, but they may not know why this helps both their oral and their overall health. Tooth decay and gum disease are almost always easily preventable. Parents have often said, "If I had only known," when faced with expensive dental treatment for their children, and especially upon learning that the problem was preventable. There is a popular saying that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, and this is true for oral health. Preventing oral health problems from developing saves a person from more serious, often painful, and expensive problems later. Public health services dental programs carry out numerous oral health promotion activities in the community to increase awareness of the importance of oral health and prevention. There are many ways to prevent oral health problems, including drinking water treated with fluoride, using dental products with fluoride, brushing at least 2 times a day, daily flossing, and having an oral health checkup by a dental professional every 6 to 9 months. Unfortunately, many people do not know this, or if they do, they do not have the means to access dental care. The factors and conditions in which a person lives affects both their overall health and oral health. The City of Hamilton has implemented numerous strategies to reduce health inequities by addressing these broader issues. A 2012 Public Health Ontario report on access to dental care and oral health reveals that income, insurance status, age, and education are strongly associated with access to dental care. Poor oral health is often affected by the social determinants of health, with the burden of dental diseases falling upon low-income families, people without dental insurance coverage, certain age groups, mostly children and seniors, new immigrant populations, and people with low levels of education. Public health service dental programs focus on these populations in order to increase awareness, reduce barriers, and increase access to dental services. Since dental care is not publicly funded, multiple determinants of health from Figure 1 create barriers to accessing oral health care services. In fact, because of access, the impact on oral health is greater than the impact on general health. The inability to access dental services is reflected in the outcomes, with sometimes profound effects to the individual, the family, and the society. In addition, some of the outcomes themselves become future determinants of oral health. For example, being unable to afford treatment may cause treatment delay, more serious complications, pain, time lost from work, and lost wages. Whether in a group setting or individually, Public Health Service dental teams assist City of Hamilton residents who cannot access or afford dental care to break this cycle. Dental treatment in Canada is paid for in one of three ways: through an employee benefit package, through government programs, or out of pocket. Not having dental insurance coverage and being low income are the two most outstanding barriers to accessing dental care. These facts hold true for Hamiltonians as well. Less than half of Hamiltonians with low incomes have dental insurance, compared to 75.8% in the middle income group and 79.9% in the high income group. Hamilton residents with high incomes report very good levels of oral health, almost 1.5 times more often than those with low incomes. Additionally, Hamilton residents in high and medium income groups were 1.5 times more likely to visit a dentist in the last 12 months than people in the low income group. Children from low income families have 2.5 times more decay than children from high income families, are less likely to receive comprehensive oral health care, and are more likely to have critical oral health problems that require emergency care than children from middle to high income families. Since parents influence children's attitudes and behaviors, their influence can affect everything from developing good dental habits, eating choices, fear of the dentist, and views on the importance of oral health and baby teeth. Yet poor dental habits and poor food choices are major contributors to developing dental decay. Parents with low incomes from minority populations and parents who are unemployed are all associated with a low utilization of preventive dental services and having children with high rates of tooth decay. The good news is that early prevention can change and provide positive oral health outcomes for children. That is why Public Health Services dental programs have a strong focus on children and families. Many seniors lose their dental coverage at retirement and or age 65. This leaves 39% of Hamilton seniors with no dental insurance coverage or with dental insurance coverage. Only 55% of Hamilton seniors had a dental visit in the last 12 months, and 36% of these people stated they only went because of a dental emergency. In Ontario, there are no provincial programs to support seniors. However, some local municipalities offer dental coverage to assist this population. In Hamilton, eligible seniors may receive emergency dental treatment at the Dental Health Bus or apply for services at the Mountain Dental Clinic. If eligible, they may also apply for special supports funding to access treatment in the community. Unfortunately for seniors, there is a focus on dental treatment, not prevention and maintenance of good oral health. These programs provide service for children ages 0 to 17, but do not address the inequities that continue to exist for adult populations. The Chief Medical Officer of Health, Dr. Arlene King, says in her report that Ontario's publicly funded dental programs is like a patchwork of services. The CINOT and HSO programs have the greatest potential to reach the largest number of children. However, their strict eligibility requirements means that many children who need care cannot get it. The $20,000 cutoff for HSO has been criticized for being much too low because it excludes many children who need care but whose families cannot afford to provide it. Furthermore, if these children have any kind of dental insurance, they are not eligible for these programs. The City of Hamilton Public Health Services dental programs administer and provide Ontario's oral health programs and municipal dental programs. The dental programs provide dental screening and follow-up until children receive treatment, preventive and dental treatment services at the Dental Health Bus, Mountain Dental Clinic, and preventive clinic locations throughout the city. claims payment for various government dental programs, community outreach activities, and water fluoridation monitoring. In 2012, the Mountain Public Health Dental Clinic dentists provided dental treatment service to over 1,350 clients. Registered dental hygienists in the clinic provided preventive services to over 2,000 clients. The dental team pays claims for provincial and municipal dental programs, including those provided to Ontario Works recipients and dependents for Ontario Disability Support Program. In addition, City of Hamilton residents who are experiencing dental problems without dental benefits and who cannot afford dental care can apply for special supports program funding for their dental treatment. The Dental Health Bus is a mobile outreach clinic that provides emergency dental services free of charge to residents of the City of Hamilton who have limited finances and no form of dental coverage. The bus is parked at 6 community locations on a weekly rotational basis. In 2012, the Dental Health Bus provided dental treatment for 1,404 clients but turned away 276 because they were over capacity. The additional dental suite on the new dental bus provides the capacity to meet this demand for service. The bus staff also provided outreach services, including harm reduction services and items including needle exchange and condoms. As well, personal hygiene supplies and hot and cold items such as hats, scarves, mittens and socks were provided to 1,060 clients. The Ontario Public Health Standards, OPHS, are expectations from the provincial government for Ontario's boards of health to provide public health programs and services that contribute to the physical, mental, and emotional health and well-being of all Ontarians. The OPHS for the Child Health Program state the goal is to enable all children to attain and sustain optimal health and developmental potential, and specifies an outcome related to oral health as an increased proportion of children have optimal oral health. City of Hamilton Public Health Services is compliant with the minimum standards required by the OPHS. The Community Dental Program provides school dental screening for children in Hamilton's elementary schools in accordance with the Ontario Public Health Standards. School risk rating is determined by the percentage of children with two or more decayed teeth, according to the protocol requirements. The protocol mandates that at a minimum, every child in JK, SK, and grade 2 receive an oral health assessment or dental screening. Some schools have additional grades screened. This is based on the school's risk rating, which may be low, medium, or high. The school's risk rating is determined by the previous year's screening of the grade 2 class. During the 2011-12 school year, 15,773 children were screened in 142 elementary schools. The OPHS Children in Need of Treatment, or CINOT, protocol standardizes case management for all screened children identified with urgent dental needs. The registered dental hygienist who does the original screening is responsible for ensuring that the child, youth, begins treatment with a dental care provider. The CINOT program is offered to families of identified children who have no dental insurance or other form of dental insurance coverage, and payment for needed dental treatment would create a financial hardship. During the 2011-12 school year, 1,587 Hamilton children were identified with urgent dental treatment needs, according to the protocol requirement, during school screening and required case management. This map was prepared using the risk rating for each elementary school screened by Public Health Services. Risk values for individual schools were calculated and plotted on the map. This map was generated using 2005 census data and shows how many children under 6 years of age are living below the low income cutoff in Hamilton. Neighborhood socioeconomic factors are significantly associated with school oral health outcomes. 11 of 17 high-risk schools, or 65%, are in wards 1 to 5. 10 of 21 medium-risk schools, or almost 50% of the medium-risk schools, are located in wards 1 to 5. Overall, of the 15,773 children screened in 2011-12, there are 4,395 students that required some type of dental treatment. The individual school data for the 5 wards for the highest level of unmet dental needs directly correlates with the corresponding neighborhood child poverty levels. Wards 2, 3, and 4 had the highest levels of unmet dental need. Children and youth with preventive needs are identified by dental screening. They are offered free preventive services if they meet the criteria found in the OPHS Preventive Oral Health Services Protocol. Preventive services include professionally applied topical fluoride, pit and fissure sealants, and scaling, and may be provided by public health dental staff. An average of 27.9% of all children screened would benefit from some preventive service. The wards with the most unmet dental needs, i.e. decay, also had higher needs for preventive services. A total of 3,743 children were screened in wards 2, 3, and 4, and more than one-third of the children seen in these wards would benefit from preventive services. In March 2012, 3 public health preventive dental services clinics were opened. These dental clinics are funded by Healthy Smiles Ontario and staffed by the Public Health Services Community Dental Program. Dental screenings and preventive dental services are available in the community and are situated in high needs areas of the city. Outside of the mandate of the OPHS, Healthy Smiles Ontario targets low-income children 17 years of age and younger and provides access to basic dental care, including diagnostic, preventive, and treatment services. This map represents the location by postal code of children enrolled in the HSO dental program. The change in color indicates an increased number of clients in the area registered on HSO. The intensification of registration color displayed correlates with the census data from Map 1. The preventive dental clinics, the Mountain Dental Clinic, and the Dental Health Bus locations are also indicated on the map. They appear to be in proximity to those areas of lower income, higher dental need, and higher HSO registration. Oral health promotion is a requirement of the OPHS and Healthy Smiles Ontario, of which raising the awareness of the importance of oral health is one component. As part of the funding proposal for HSO, public health units were encouraged to collaborate and build upon existing relationships with internal and external partners to raise awareness of the importance of oral health, improve oral health outcomes, and increase access to dental services. Public health services dental programs continually connect with community groups to achieve these goals. The dental teams continually use evidence to inform decision-making, whether in the clinic or out in the community. Learning resources are developed and maintained for children and their families. For example, the teacher resource kits are based on the Ontario curriculum to better support teachers in the classroom. The Rethink Your Drink display was updated to reflect current beverage consumption by youth. Many youth are now consuming energy drinks, for example Red Bull, so the current display shows the sugar content of this drink. So this report provides an overview of the oral health of Hamilton residents in comparison with Canadian and Ontario data. The social determinants of health offer an explanation why people do not or cannot access dental care, the barriers they face, and the related oral health outcomes. Inequities in oral health persist, and public health services strives to address these needs in the community. It has been shown that access to care has the greatest impact on oral health outcomes, more so than oral health behaviors. Poor oral health and the inability to afford dental treatment affect more people of all ages with low incomes, and an increasing number of people are not getting the dental care they need. It is important to continue and increase oral health promotion and health advocacy and put the mouth back in the body. Raising awareness about the importance of good oral health and its effects on oral health encourages people to take action so that costly, painful, and extensive dental treatment can be minimized. We presented Health Services dental programs. We hope this information has provided a framework on how the dental team delivers programs and services to support City of Hamilton residents in accessing and receiving dental care. Results from provincially mandated programs are provided as evidence to guide future programming and delivery of services.
Thank you for that. And I have a speaker's list, starting off with Councillor Whitehead.
I appreciate the presentation. I guess the first question, because the methodology is always determine whether we're getting good information. Is it accurately reflecting what's taking place? So I need to really clearly understand, every child in a school will be looked, their teeth will be looked at, or is it a voluntary program where they can access the public health or whatever the program is? I'm trying to understand, is that a mandated program or is it a volunteer program? If it's a volunteer program, that's a big difference.
It's a mandated program, but I will ask Pat Tester, who's manager of the community dental program that looks after school screening, to more fully answer your question.
The reason I'm asking is because my two children has never gone through a screening program at Jerome School, so I need to understand, if this is a mandated program, how come they haven't gone through a program?
Okay, so I will ask Pat to answer that question.
Through you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Whitehead, the program is mandated by the Province of Ontario. We send out a letter to students prior to the dental screening, and at that time parents can opt out of the screening if they choose to.
Okay, so not every child is being screened then?
Every child is offered a screening in grades.
Yeah, but I think the difference between it's a mandated program, but parents and children aren't mandated to participate in it. Is that what I'm hearing?
Through you, Mr. Chair, yes. It's a mandated program, but we can't require all parents to be part of that program, but we offer it in JKSK in grade 2, and we give parents that opportunity.
What percentage of people are not participating in the program?
Through you, Mr. Chair, exactly, I'm not sure, but it's very few children. We might have 5 people not participate.
95% compliance from 800 students at Jerome School.
In the selected grades screened.
The next question is, I guess my concern is always when we go through programs, we already have an outcome that's, my opinion, is predetermined. That is, it's a poverty issue, and we'll focus this around poverty when we may exclude a broader issue. I'm going to give you an example. Many people have insurance, as you indicated, 60%. But do we know within that 60% how many of them are actually vigilantly accessing dental care?
Would you know that?
Indicating that of the 60% that have access to dental care, what percentage of those people that are so-called in the affordable bracket, that middle class, are actually accessing dental care? Because, again, I can give you an example. Well, we did a survey when I was with the steelworkers, because we had a great dental program, and we were amazed how many people were not exercising that dental program. But I guess my point is, I don't want to make this just a poverty issue, when, in fact, I think there's a broader issue here that we need to highlight.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. There is that information in our fact bulletin. I don't happen to have it right now in front of us, but you're right. Some people who have dental insurance don't access care. We can send that along afterwards.
Okay, I appreciate it. And again, it's for me, I want to know that we're not going with a predisposed position and then we go out and prove it. I want to know that we're going in there and say, okay, dental health is important to our community. Who has access to it, who's exercising access to it, and how, you know, what is our findings relative to the cause and issue, those cause issues. So I have a full picture, and I'm not looking at a picture that seems to be looking through a narrow view. Could you safely say to me and make me feel comfortable that this, the way this report was done, was an open-ended study and in fact didn't go in with that pre-conclusion?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. We have done an extensive lit review and exploration of the various different, you know, like stats and surveys that are done on health. And so this is what came out of that. In response to your early comment, if I could say, is that you know, one of the challenges of our program is to get the message out there that oral health is important. And so we certainly do see people that do have dental insurance that aren't accessing oral health because they haven't really thought of it as important until there's a problem. So it's also part of our work that we're doing to make sure that everyone has good oral health, whether they have dental insurance or not.
That's where I'm driving, is I think that there's a bigger issue here in the context of ensuring that everyone is aware how important oral health is and that they should, if they have access to it, certainly understand and appreciate the stats you put up and those that don't. But certainly those ones that do need to take it a little more seriously, because I believe that there's a percentage of people that have the access but don't exercise that access. You can see it in their children. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. And on my speakers list, I believe we have Councillor Farr, Marula, Morelli, and McCaddy. Councillor Farr.
Well, first through you, Mr. Mayor, I would commend Glenda and staff with respect to the report as a whole, and particularly page 27 of 51, when I read that with regards to the dental bus, we're expanding the profile. We're utilizing resources to full capacity and going beyond just dental services, providing outreach services while they're in their locations, which is wonderful. Needle exchange, condoms, hygiene supplies, hot and cold items, scarves on winter days, and that's very impressive to see us thinking outside the box like that for this and other health initiatives that we have here in the city. And this one, of course, 100% municipally funded with help from our partners like the Hamilton Community Foundation, if I'm not mistaken, and others. So well done there. But a question with regards to the health bus. And it represents the new beautiful dental health bus that was parked out front City Hall. I think it was in late October, and everybody had a good look at it then. But it has an additional chair. And through you, Mr. Mayor, does this additional chair mean we can now assume something relatively close to doubling up on our services because we have an additional chair? So we did service, according to the report, about 1,400 clients. We couldn't get to 276. Now that we have two chairs, we know we can cover the 276 and then some. So to what capacity will we double it up to about 2,800 through you, Mr. Mayor?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, yes, that capacity is there. We're also looking at, you know, other ways to use that service as well, perhaps offering some of our Healthy Smiles Ontario preventive services there. We want to use the bus to its full capacity. So some of those preventive treatments haven't typically been a huge part of the services we provide on the dental health bus, but it allows us that capacity to grow the services to the people that need it the most.
Okay, so is there an opportunity then that do you think that we can get, knowing that the extra chair means extra capacity, will we look at that then maybe next year when you bring this report, or I don't know when the next report is coming with dental health care, but will we be able to have a look at a firm number and see it positively change from the 1,400 to something greater than is what you're saying? Okay, that's good, Glenda. And then my second question comes from page 31 of 51, and my final question, Mr. Mayor, through you. There's the graph, figure 6, that shows some 4,400 students requiring some type of dental treatment, and then you break it down nicely in this report. And the concerning one is up top, about 1,500, 1,600 cases of unmet urgent dental needs requiring immediate care. I'm wondering on that as well about follow-up. The report says that there's a case management required. Does that include following up on particularly those emergency or urgent items, issues with kids, our students in the city, and will we see that at all at some point through you?
If I understand your question, so you're talking about the follow-up for those urgent dental needs. So part of the requirement for this particular sign-up protocol is that the registered dental hygienist follows up with each of those children and their parents to ensure that they get the urgent dental treatment in whichever way we can get it to them. And so, and we would follow up that all the way to if absolutely necessary, and additionally doesn't get to here, but we're following up with Children's Aid to incur, to get the treatment done for the children. So it's something that we follow right through to the end.
Wonderful. That was the response I was looking for. And again, great report. Thank you very much. Thanks, Mr. Mayor.
Thanks, Councillor. Councillor Marula, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Glenda, let me take this opportunity to thank you for this very thorough report, and I really, really appreciate it. And I can honestly say I understand the issue. I think you have to separate some of the issues that are before us. Through you, Mr. Mayor, Glenda, I think what we need to elaborate on, because some of what was said, I think, speaks of not grasping what this is all about. So we really, when you're dealing with dental care or access to dental care, there are really many variables that contribute to the lack of access, one predominantly being poverty, and others, if they have access to dental care but not exercising that access, would be really a parenting issue. Would you not say through you, Mr. Mayor?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, yes, I would agree. For children, yes.
And our primary objective with this report is to deal specifically with the poverty issues as it correlates to access to dental care and increasing awareness?
Yes, through you, Mr. Mayor. It's for both of those things. I mean, I think the reason for this report is not just to focus on the very urgent need of children in poverty, because that's certainly important, but to focus on oral health as something that helps us all to be healthier. And it's not just about poverty, it's also about, you know, having prevention and taking care of your teeth and recognizing that it's important.
So it's all those variables that contribute to it, that increases the awareness surrounding it and addressing it by trying to increase access to dental care, thereby preventing any type of prolonged problems associated with not accessing it. Is that correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, yes. And it's not access to dental treatment per se. It's the maintenance, the prevention that costs much less than having to, you know, deal with a dental emergency, urgent treatment, decay, that kind of.
And another aspect that I think I'd like to touch on, having two dentists in my family, I understand that the demand for dentists in this city is, it's pretty significant. And also the discussion surrounding universal care. Through you, Mr. Mayor, has there been any thought from our public health department to evaluate potentially endorsing a universal dental care province-wide? And how far have we gone into that type of discussion?
There's a lot of, through you, Mr. Mayor, there's a lot of advocacy on a number of different levels. The Ontario Academy of Public Health Dentists and certainly health departments and anyone who touches on this area has been advocating the province to, you know, at the very least, bring all of the complex different programs that have various different rules and subsidies together in something. And I don't know that we've gone as far as advocating for universal dental care, but certainly for those who are in greatest need, to break down the barriers between all of those different programs that have such strict rules of eligibility.
Because I think it's important, Mr. Mayor, to recognize that we've actually reversed some of the treatment from a universal perspective from health OHIP, have we not? Have we not eliminated some services from OHIP over the years? So it's actually through you, Mr. Mayor, to whoever would like to answer that question.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, that's correct. OHIP over the years, as they've gone through reviews of what's covered and not, they've delisted some services at times.
Okay. Which highlights or truly stresses the need for us to perhaps have this come to the forefront again. So through you, Mr. Mayor, if we could, perhaps maybe even offline, firstly, so I can bring forward a notice of motion, to draft a resolution which would be reflective of the need to advocate for a universal care, or at least a hybrid, so that there's some sort of standard minimum care that could be universal, and perhaps other options. Through you, Mr. Mayor, would that be something that we could perhaps discuss offline, and I can present it as a notice of motion today for future discussion?
Mr. Mayor, that's certainly something that we could look at doing.
Okay, so at the appropriate time, I'll bring that forward as a notice of motion, I'll speak to Dr. Richardson offline with respect to it. And lastly, that's about it, and thank you very much once again.
Thank you, Councillor, and we'll hear a notice later on. Councillor Morelli, and then McCaddy, and then Collins.
No, I'm just saying to Councillor Morelli that I have two members of my family who are dentists too. I'm not sure whether it makes any difference, but I'm going to, I want to just, I've had a bit of experience in terms of constituency dealing with this, and Glenda, thank you for the report. I think obviously poverty is a piece of it, but did I understand you correctly that in one of your conclusions is access to care is the barrier? Did you definitively say that's the barrier?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's one of the barriers, and part of the challenge was, as we've spoken earlier, with the different even subsidized dental programs, is that the eligibility doesn't include everybody. I mean, I think of the working poor who may not reach that $20,000, you know, under that, and so there's people that where that isn't a problem, where the access to care is a problem. So it's so multifaceted, unfortunately. So it's not the only barrier.
Hey, Mr. Chair, would you suggest that it's 50, 60, 70% of the issue? I mean, obviously, you know, I'm struggling with that because one of the experiences, Mr. Chairman, that I've had is that every time I've had a constituent come to my office with the issue, and I've worked with staff with the bus, and somehow I've always been able to facilitate their need regardless. And of course, I think the new one of the populations that you cited were the new immigrants in this community. And having adopted 38 Vietnamese myself, that's one of the areas where I've seen it in practice, where they didn't have the income, but it, in many cases they're self-employed. So I'm not sure what, but the access was always there through you, Mr. Chairman. So you know, I need to be convinced that it's the access. I'm picking up a little bit on Councillor Brule and Councillor Farr because I think that we need to look at the parenting, the awareness, which leads me to the next piece, which is, and I think Councillor Brule's hit on this, do we have much of an interface with the dental association? Because that's another area, because of, again, my exposure to the dentist, who fear everything from capitation to universal care. But they claim that they have an emergency service operation in place, and do we interface that, and is the awareness out there of that operation? I mean, I've seen them take their weekends where they're on call or whatever. So through you, Mr. Chairman, to Glenda, is that integrated with what we're involved with here?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, we are making a lot of connections with our dental association. Dr. Peter Weeb is our public health dentist, meets regularly with the dentist associations here in Hamilton. And there are many dentists who provide access to care and, you know, providing that care for urgent needs. So there is access out there. I would say it's still patchwork. So it's just how we can build those connections better within the community, working with ourselves, working with other community agencies so that people know where to go to get those services, because it's not necessarily phoning up a dentist and saying I can come to that the dentist and say come. There are some dental providers that will provide that level of service to anyone, and then there's others who would ask them to go elsewhere. So it's just part of getting those communications and the partnerships built within the community. So I don't know whether that answers your question. I don't have a concrete number, but we're building those relationships. Yes.
On my sheet, I have, you referred to the patchwork of services and the strict eligibility in your presentation today through you, Mr. Chairman, and probably the point that I would make is that I'm not so interested in how it got developed, but if it's not meeting the needs, how do we fix the patchwork would be one of the questions that I would have. And the second one, I didn't have to answer that, but I think that's where my focus would go, given that I think the access is a little bit more accessible than I think, you know, it's just not poverty that says they don't go. I think that's my experience. The other one that I had worked with the late Dr. Jim Morielli, in another area that I've encountered where we have seniors, Mr. Chairman, that are living in homes, that my mother was a classic example where, you know, she could point, even in her Alzheimer's state, that she was having a problem with a pain in her tooth. And I remember Dr. Morielli at St. Peter's talking about their program, and he was kind enough at the time to, you know, my mother wasn't really mobile and was frightened, so he went in to see her and had Morelli. So I just, is that service, are we integrating with that kind of service? Is it continuing? Because that was a big, one of the big things that he really spoke about with a passion, and actually, you know, does address a very critical need, because you've mentioned, I know as a former employee, past employee at the FASCO, they carry on with providing dental care to their retirees, but I know that's not true even here unless you pick up a plan of some sort subsequent to your retirement. So do we, is that still in place, and is that still sort of defined as an available service to you, Mr. Chairman? And are we aware of that? That was St. Peter's. Anyone got an answer to that?
I'm just trying to see who could best answer that question.
Through you, Mr. Chair, Public Health Services is not associated, although there is private dentists out there that do provide services.
I can hardly hear you, but are you telling me that that service is no longer available at St. Pete's?
At St. Pete's? No, I'm not sure of that.
Through you, Mr. Chair, we don't know that, so we'll look into that. Most of our focus within Ontario Public Health Standards has generally been on the children 0 to 17, so we do recognize that this is an area where we might want to do some more connecting. Just
Doctor, you need to know there was a program, if it doesn't still exist, but he was leading it at St. Peter's as a geriatric unit. I think that's important for us to know as well, because that's also a piece of our population that somewhat doesn't need to be impoverished, but certainly doesn't have access or awareness. Okay, there are my comments. I mean, I think we need to, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the report, and I think we need to focus on probably developing ways of communicating what is out there and educating people to the need for dental care. Because I can tell you, even in those that have coverage, there's a culture out there of probably the largest demographic group that has certainly improved in their dental care, but they haven't really improved a whole lot from the days of when you only went to see the dentist when there was a problem. And if you really don't believe me, then just take a look at the mouths of people over 65, and you'll get a good idea of what I'm talking about. Thank you.
Thank you. We have Councillor McCaddy.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. I, too, was going to ask about sort of the network of dentists to see whether they're stepping up to provide so many hours of pro bono work per dentist or any kind of organized way of doing that. It sounds like between the Marula and Morelli families alone, there's four or five dentists that could step up. So maybe we can start with those families and go from there. So it sounds like there's some work on that, but it's not entirely organized. It's developing relationships. So I think maybe that's something we'd like to hear back on a bit more in the future. Is there a formal network? Is there any role for us to play in encouraging that? Would be helpful. Just on Appendix A, page 16, there's a figure 2 there which talks about the average per person public spending on dental care by province and territory. And I just want to make sure I understood that, because it's quite a jarring figure, with Ontario at $5 and, if I'm reading that correctly, 67 cents, compared to the next one, New Brunswick, at onwards of $14, and then it goes up from there. So is that combined public spending? Is that part of the system we have in Ontario, where municipalities have to pay for social services generally? The only group, of course, in the G8 that does that, the only province, the only government that does that in the whole G8. Is that what that's about? So if you added in the municipal spending, that would be more, or is that just the province itself, the $5.67? Mr. Mayor, through you.
I'm going to ask somebody else to take that question.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Our understanding is, yes, when CIHI does this data, that they do pull in all sources of public spending, and it doesn't matter where it might have come from, what level of government.
Okay, well, that's, I mean, what else can you say than that's shocking, that the province of Ontario is, you know, less than half of the next comparable province, and it just kind of goes up from there. You know, Quebec at $20, almost, you know, four times what Ontario spends. So I guess I would ask, knowing something about dental health across the country, some of the information we have here for Hamilton, if we were to look at Montreal, for example, or Halifax or some other city and where the province contributes a lot more money, and I guess if this is combined spending, that it would be the province and the municipalities, and I guess the federal government, if there's any federal dollars in here, do they experience much better outcomes than us, Mr. Mayor, through you on that one?
Through Mr. Mayor, I would have that answer today, but that would be certainly worth looking into.
Yeah, I think this sort of fits into Councillor Marula's comment about on the advocacy side of this, that we need a universal dental system or some sort of a system. I mean, you might even advocate that Ontario puts as much money in as New Brunswick does, and we might be off to the races. So I think it's important to understand that a bit better. If particularly, Mr. Mayor, we are often critical of the province on a variety of subjects, and we could be critical on this one, it would appear. But I keep thinking there must be something missing here, because we're way behind in Ontario, and I'm surprised we're that far behind. So maybe if that could be fleshed out a little bit, and you know, if we were to ask the province to step up their game, if they put another $5 in per person, would we be there in Ontario? We'd still be below everybody else. So I'm not sure how that relates to outcomes. It may have something to do with fluoride in the water. I hesitate to touch that one, but maybe that's the answer here, that we're doing better. So just a better understanding of that, Mr. Mayor, I think would help helpful for us. And the last thing I would say, and this is sort of a general comment, I think, to Elizabeth, Dr. Richardson, I think when you're hearing the questions and comments of the members of the Board of Health, it's clear to me that they're looking for something to do with this report. Information reports are quite difficult for us because you have to kind of probe around to determine what needs to be done. I mean, I don't think you're saying that everything's perfect. I think I got that part. But I would really encourage public health to provide recommendations in the future. Try and avoid as many information reports as you can, unless it's a really straightforward, quick update on something. But to actually provide recommendations on what you would like the Board of Health to support, or perhaps recommendations on further research, that provincial thing I just mentioned. Because I think if you listen here, we're kind of probing, we're kind of trying to find where the improvements could occur. So that would be only my last recommendation, and that's sort of a universal recommendation for all information reports. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and through you, a great presentation and a very good report. My apologies for missing your first couple of slides. And I agree with some of the other speakers. It's really hard to believe that, you know, we've lived with a universal health care system for decades now, and preventative maintenance as part of an oral health program is still not part of it. So that, hopefully there's something we can do on our end to help out in that regard from an advocacy standpoint. We are part of the system and the network, and we do provide resources, and through you, Mr. Mayor, then when I look at the map 3 where you illustrate the Healthy Smiles Ontario participant locations, and you provided the map of the areas where we're servicing through office work as well as the community health bus, and I know that it was just, I think it was 2008 that we finally delivered the community health bus to Riverdale, which is, I think, based on your map, the highest need area in the city. And so I know that, you know, resources are always an issue for us with everything that we do, including these services. But you do have a number of other areas that you have that colored scale there, with red being the highest need. And there are some, it looks like on the map at least, some underserviced areas as it relates to either a building that would service a community, or in this case, when I refer to my Riverdale as the community health bus. And when I look at the map, again, from a parochial standpoint, for both Councillor Marula and I, it seems like there are two other areas that are underserviced from on both sides of the Red Hill Valley. One would be my Quigley Road area, which is a high-need area, a lot of economic challenges, certainly for some of the residents who live in that area. And so I'm wondering, what is our plan, knowing that we can play, we can advocate to the provincial government that, you know, we want to see more programs for not just children in Ontario and here in Hamilton, but for seniors and everyone else in between. But what are we doing with our own resources to enhance the services that we already provide? And so if, for instance, my Davis Creek planning team was to come forward as part of their community development initiative with Paul Johnson and all the good things that are occurring, and they're to say that, you know what, there are some oral health care needs in our community. We're underserviced from a city standpoint. We'd like to see the community health bus. Do we have a short, medium, and long-term plan as it relates to enhancing services or rolling out new services to neighborhoods that are currently without?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, excellent question. I think that this report has provided us now the information that can help us do our program planning. And I see sort of two areas where we could make some changes based on looking at this. One is that next year, and when public health moves downtown, the clinic, the dental clinic, will be moving from Upper Ottawa to downtown. And that says to me that we need to look at where the dental bus is now going, because the dental clinic will be downtown. So looking at, you know, the best way to distribute those resources. The other one is in our Healthy Smiles Ontario preventive clinics. One is permanently located in the East End with our sexual health program and some of the other clinics we operate there. But the other two are mobile. They're not mobile in the sense that you can just kind of move equipment around from location to location every day. But what we have tried to do is work with the community and, you know, made some connections with Paul Johnson and his group to look at where the need is and then perhaps move that clinic there for a period of time and then go to another spot. So there is some ability to move those resources around to meet the need. So I think, you know, what we're sharing with you today is really, you know, information as we pull together really helps us to plan for the next year or so.
Mr. Mayor, if I can just add to that as well, sorry. just there's a few other opportunities that will come up as we go through the consolidation phase and with a community initiative that's underway. Dr. Frank Stecky in the community has been looking at a community clinic and that the dentists themselves may be able to provide directly. And so that's another opportunity. I think they're looking in the Sherman and Barton area. And then as we bring the dental clinic downtown in 2014, that'll sort of shift potentially where those locations are. As Glenda was saying earlier, looking at the bus and where it goes, we've got double the capacity on the bus, but unfortunately to move it every day is the most we can do. We can't move it more than every day, but we could certainly look at as those resources shift and with Dr. Stecky's initiative comes online, you know, one of the things would be to look at this and then look at where we might change the mapping in 2014 for the bus, the routing I should say, for the bus.
Thank you for that. And in terms of the cost, certainly there's the capital cost of purchasing the bus, a new bus, and retrofitting it to prepare it for you know, servicing the community. But in terms of the staffing costs associated, the operational cost of a bus, is that how it's funded annually in terms of, is it per location that there's a cost per location? Is there a per day cost? Is it an annual cost for the bus? So how, if we're looking at, and I can tell you that I'm almost certain that the Davis Creek Planning Group will most likely request some type of community health bus service. And so I'm trying to prepare myself from a budget standpoint to understand what needs there are and what the requirements are to implement such a service, knowing that we might have capacity to free up some existing time and allocate it somewhere is, I think, a positive step. But I see over time as our population, as the city increases, these sort of red blobs on the map are going to become larger and most likely they'll be located in more locations. So what is the annual cost of providing the community health bus service to a neighborhood and B, to provide that provision of a bus on a calendar year to the community in general?
So we operate the bus as an effect program. So all of the staffing is part of that bus and the cost of running that bus. And then we move the bus, you know, once a day to a different location. And it's really the, it wouldn't be possible to move it more often, just be inefficient. So in that sense, we would be adjusting the six or five locations that we go to now and possibly redistributing them. And that would be a status quo. For us to provide more service would mean an additional dental bus going to a different area. But our mobile clinics are ones that we operate within a community agency. So Pat's Community Dental Health Team you know, would go to a community agency, and if they have the right room and, you know, the kinds of requirements, then they can operate that clinic within a community agency. So that means that you don't have to use capital funds and all of those kinds of things to start up a clinic. That can be helpful.
And what's the cost of those two services, one in a clinic and the other in the bus?
You know,
apart from the capital costs of purchasing the bus, the operational costs of both of those
services?
I don't
have that right in front of me, and I wouldn't want to misquote, but I think it's, no, yeah. I'd have to let you know that. I'm sorry, I don't have
I'd
that number.
I'd be interested
number.
To know that, Mr. Mayor, at some point in time. Those are the only questions and comments that I have, and again, I want to thank you for a very comprehensive presentation and a report. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Ferguson, could you take the chair, please, as Deputy Mayor? And sure. I'll, for the information of the Board of Health, I did have a meeting with Minister McMeekin, Dr. Wiebe, members of the Dental Association, and we had quite a comprehensive discussion on this. Outcomes, as Councillor McCaddy suggested, are the important thing, and part of the outcome was the preparation of this report so that we have more information to move ahead with. But I can tell you that some of the things that were discussed were more clinics, more public clinics, and in accessible areas, because it was hard to figure why, if most of the needs were here, that the public clinic was at Upper Ottawa and then the bus was providing service elsewhere. And among the discussions that were held was, through you, Mr. Deputy Mayor, the new McMaster downtown facility. Would that be an appropriate place to find some clinic space? But anyway, that matter is being dealt with in terms of moving the clinic down. And there is another factor, though, that wasn't quite captured here, and that's dentures. And so, through you, Mr. Deputy Mayor, has that issue been discussed, the post-dentist stuff, you know, the denture provision? Because my understanding is that there are a lot of really neat, nice guys out there who will take on clients, but I'm not sure whether there's a specific plan for dentures. So through you, Glenda, could you update me on that?
Through you, Mr. Deputy Mayor, I'm not sure that I can give you a lot of information. Our Ontario Works Partners and Community Services Department certainly have a plan that provides dentures for people who, or pays for dentures for people who can't afford it, who are on those programs. It's not something that we offer within public health.
Right. But that's fine.
Can I answer anymore?
No, I'm good with that, because the what we have, in other words, is a comprehensive group of ideas that are moving forward through the Minister's office, through the Dental Association. But we needed lots of data, which is a report. But I couldn't agree with Councillor McCaddy more in terms of what's the specific recommendation and how will we move forward. And I think it may be to approach the ministry through Minister McMeekin. Once we've determined what the realm and range of needs are, and as we heard, what is the cost of the health bus and so on, so that we can come up with a number, part of a number which would certainly be funded at higher levels, and move forward from there. So I'll finish by saying, Glenda, thank you. This is a great report, lots of teeth in this, if you will, and we will see that the ministry receives this report and the information as we continue that discourse. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You can take the chair back. There are no further speakers.
Thank you. So, on the report, I need a motion to receive it. Councillor Collins, Councillor Jackson, all in favor?
Carried.
That's carried. Thank you very much. So, notices and motions, we have none. We do have the Medical Officer of Health taking, talking to the board with respect to the Education Forum, Dr. Richardson.
Mr. Mayor, can I just ask, did we move 8.1?
Sorry?
Item 8.1 on today's agenda.
I had it all scratched out with names here, I'm sorry. So, on the 8.1 respecting the Hamilton Central Health Link, Councillor McCaddy.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. This is the Hamilton Central Health Link, and I just wonder if I could get a little briefing on this, maybe just a five-minute description of what is going on. I think I understand it, but before I ask questions, I I wonder if I could just ask staff to say a few words about this. I think it's focusing on the number of folks that spend an awful lot of time in the ER and with problems. But just a quick briefing, Mr. Mayor, through you.
Yes. Who'd like to do that?
Through you, Dr. Mr. Mayor.
Go ahead.
I'll ask actually Brent to take that on. Brent has, of course, joined us as the Director of Community Health Planning and Integration, and it's largely around this issue that we created the role. And so, Brent, I'll turn it over to you.
Through the mayor to council, thanks Councillor McCaddy for this question. This program is called Health Links. It's a new model of delivering health care initiated by the Ministry of Health, and it's coordinated by through the LHINs, and the McMaster Family Medicine is the executive lead for that, Dr. David Price, who you've met before. Notionally, what it is to coordinate the care plans for patients and sharing information across healthcare disciplines and across the broader view of healthcare, applying the social determinants of health, which, as you know, in public health is one of our key focuses, and to reduce duplication. In the initial year of the project, it's focusing on 5% of the population that accounts for about two-thirds of the healthcare dollars. The catchment area for the Hamilton Central Health Links is from Highway 403 to Nash Road, going from the lake and up to the escarpment. That represents about 29% of the population of Hamilton, and in this process, in the first year, it'll focus on approximately 320 persons that live in that catchment area that are high users of both inpatient of the hospital and the emergency department and various resources that we have, that we offer here at the city. The interventions that will be employed in the first year include something called a learning circle, where healthcare professionals and social workers and community care workers will focus on individual patients, share the information about that patient, and coordinate their care plans and learn from those patients how we can better serve